So now we approach the final part of this concrete chapter, which is about usage of potential, of potential or bound proven existence of equilibria and bound efficiency of equilibria. And that's called facility location. Of course, there are many games which are called facility location games. We're just looking at actually several, several, but very important, central one. Definitely not the only one. So we have looked at now at networking. And networking is, and that's the typo, is often needed to provide services. Now we can also look about services in a more explicit way. So what if you have financially motivated service providers, those are the agents, and they need to provide service to certain users, they charge the users for the services, and they use, of course, seek the cheapest available service. So we are looking at the facility location paper by Vetta from 2002. And let me just check. Yes, so there we have AK facilities, which each is basically chosen by a player, so there are K players. And the players could locate those facilities and serve the clients. And the clients, so the pricing is selfish. Of course, each one of the players is selfish. The players locate the facilities. Then the clients also rationally simply choose the cheapest option. And of course, we are going to ask about the equilibria and what is the efficiency. We are going to see if the equilibria exists, because the potential game, and of course the finite game, because there is going to be a finite number of locations for each facility, and the price final cash is going to be small. That's a nice example of not only some nice tools which we use in the analysis, which can be used in many other places, of course, but we also like it to prove that even the price of anarchy is small, the price of stability will be one. So concretely, each service provider from QE has a set AI of possible locations for the facility, which is ruled by the service provider. So those locations can be seen as strategies of the strategies of this service provider. And the set of all the locations, A, basically, it's a set of all the possible locations. But again, each service provider, each player, and the players here are only the service providers, at least in the model we are looking at now. We also will see that there is an equivalent model where both the service providers and the users of the services play, but that's going to be just an equivalent model. We are going to describe and show why it's equivalent, how it can be seen equivalent, but that's not going to be what we analyze. So what we analyze, the service providers will be actually the only players, and the users will be just doing something we'll describe exactly. And so those players, each has a part of the strategy set AI. So again, the strategy set, the strategy profile is, of course, the cross product of AI. The union is something else. That's simply the, all the possible facilities. That's not something which we define in a general game. In a general game, just uniting all the strategy sets of the players does not make sense. For example, I choose which attack to make, and some other chooses, other person chooses which defense to undertake, so it's kind of meaningless to unite our strategy set. We can define this set, but it's meaningless. So again, let's go back. You have those service providers, those are the players, and each has the possible facility locations for the only facility that the player locates. And there, having a customer J from locations SI from allocation SI in AI, of course, that's a given thing, the cost of serving J from SI. Now, customer J values this service as P or Pi. I think we call it in American Pi, but that's called the P, Greek letter, as Pi J. So that's the value of the customer for the for service. Does not matter who services the customer, the value is pi, and the benefit, the utility of the customer, but again, it's something which is not going to be relevant so much because the customers are not seen as players, but we'll see something about that later. The, so to speak, utility is the value of the customer from the service minus the price she pays. And the price is something smaller than the value, of course, which is set by the service provider. In turn, the service provider sends this utility, basically the revenue, which is the price minus price she sets and obtains, minus the cost which she needs to bear in order to be able to service that person. J from location SI, and the location is free, but the cost costs that. That's how we look at it. Because you can look at it different manners, but that's how we look at this here. Now, this service generates the social value from the point of view of society, and we assume that we don't care about the price, because that's simply an exchange of something between two participants. Now, again, since the customers are not so much players, that's not necessarily clear, but that's how we depends on our definition. So we define that what is interested is the total sum of what the customer gets and what the service providers get, or what the customers get and what the service provider get, what the service providers get. And for such a couple, the sum is, of course, pi j minus c, so the sum of price minus the cost, and the value minus the price. So the surplus, the generated value, so to speak, for the society is the value minus how much it costs to provide it. And that's independent of the price. Now, the social welfare is the sum of all the providers and the customers of these, depending, of course, who provides the service to whom, so of all the provider-customer couples, where this is the customer which is provided by this provider. And that's the social value. Without also generality, we assume that the PJs is always at least the CJs, because for any customer, any service provider, and SI in the set, in the location set of for the facility of the service provider, and that does not lose the generality, because the only assignments which can yield positive social value are such where IJ is at least EJ SI. So let's recap quickly what we have seen till now and continue. So each service provider from the set I 1 to K has a set of possible facility locations. So the customer gets what she values, how much she values the service, minus the price. The service provider gets price minus the cost for her to provide the service. And then, of course, the total society value, what we call the society value, is simply pi J minus the cost. And given a strategy profile, each customer is assigned to the, now we need to know how the providers behave. Now the question is, how do customers behave? So if you don't look at them as players, we just tell how they behave. That's the typical approach here. Yeah? So they're just always assigned to the least costly facility for her, of course, randomly choosing if there are several, and the price charge. When customer J uses the location SI, or PTI is of service provider IX facility is the minimum cost among what that J could have got from any other service provider I prime, or what any other service provider could have provided. Or let's say so. The question is how much it would cost. What would be the least price that another service provider, another service provider I prime, would have given? And that least price is simply the cost for the service provider to provide service to J. That's why, and that's kind of the second. The idea here is similar to the idea of second price auction. People know that. So that the least cost has to be there. And so basically, I choose allocation and I charge you by the maximum price I can give you, which is still not strictly larger than someone else's price. So that's the highest possible price. Again, the service providers choose locations, and then customers go to the least costly facility. The price depends as follows, and the prices, and then we know what exactly each one obtains. So that's the game. And we have defined the total social cost, by the way, as the sum of the PI minus the cost of providing the facility to J. So the social cost of client J obtaining the service from facility I located at SI is. The social value is as follows. So that's the cost of this service with minus and plus the actual utility that gives to the client. And then summing of all those possible service providers, we get the social value. Now, another important is that this approach can be actually emulated by the following extensive game. And in this game, both providers and customers are strategic. So here we look at all the providers and customers and as players, but only on this slide. That's the only case where we look at both of them as players. So here the providers just selected facility locations. Then the providers set the prices, and then the users, which are also players, finally select the provider and pay the set price. They select the provider based on the price, of course, and pay the set price. Now, the analysis when to take under which this model is equivalent to what we just did, to the Nash equilibria in the model we just did, has to look at the solution concept, which is called the G. Again, I'm going really quickly over this, but we may go a bit deeper to those. Extensive games. Now I'm just going really quick. So the analysis we undertake employs the generalization of some subgame perfect equilibrium, which is a solution concept. So with concept of what is stable for extensive games, when you have several steps. And in subgame perfect equilibrium, you have to have the conditions of a Nash equilibrium that everyone best responds to what others do, plus that Nash equilibrium condition has to hold at any stage, but any possible stage on this game tree. Now we look at something stronger, generalization in the sense of refinement, actually, that's called trampling hand perfect equilibrium for extensive games. And what we have here is that in addition to that, not only do we look at every possible subtree, but we also require this equilibrium be a limit of the following equilibrium. So the idea is as follows. What if the players can make mistakes with a known but small but known probability? I want, not only do I want to be good against what happens in any place in the subtree, which is provided by the sub, required by sub game perfection, but I also want to be good against any mistake. So that's what is required, and that will prevent the situation where you have providers who choose unprofitably low prices in this model. Providers choose prices freely. It's not like what we defined. And then those unprofitably low prices be chosen such that they force the other providers to lower their prices too. But so we just need to look at this solution concept in order for this game to actually emulate the model we just defined. And formally, we look at each player picking a uniformly randomized strategy with some probability epsilon. That's the probability of a mistake, the idea of scrambling hand, mistake, or some thinking on the behalf of the player which we don't understand, discrepancy in the information that player has about the game, whatever. The probability of the error is epsilon, with probability 1 minus epsilon, the player has the best response. Now, given this game, consider a subgame perfect equilibrium in this epsilon perturbed game, and define a trembling hand perfect equilibrium as a limit of such equilibrium when epsilon goes to 0. And that's under the assumption this extensive game actually emulates the game we just defined, where only the service providers were players, where we looked at Nash equilibrium. Now, forget this emulation, it's just nice for intuition for now. And let's go back to the game we defined, where only the service providers were players, and where we look at the Nash equilibrium, and let's analyze what happens there. Well, first of all, that it's a potential game. The social welfare is a potential function in this case. It's very simple here. We don't have to go far to look for a potential function. So social welfare is a potential function for the facility location game. I remind that the social welfare is the sum of all the couples that this service provides to this user, one facility located somewhere. The sum of the value the user derives from that is i j, minus the cost. It costs to provide that service from that location. Now, first, how do we prove the potential function? We first assume the provider I drops out and show, so not like changes, but just stops doing anything, stops providing any service. That's a material step. And show that the utility of the provider is going to be the value social of society before dropping out minus the value after the provider is simply removed. Now, why? Because when I drops out, then every customer which was served by I moved to a second best choice, which cost exactly the price. That's how we define the price. So the cost provided the service increases by exactly the difference between the price, which is the cost of a second best choice, and the original cost. Now that's exactly equal. Now the cost increased by that, since the value for the customer probably remains the same. That's the decrease in the social welfare. That's this. Wait. That's the decrease in social welfare for this customer, J. Now that's exactly equal to the profit of Play-I or gain from serving this customer J. By definition, the price is 2 minus the cost of the Play-I provided service. Now, what about changing the strategy? Because we don't look at this opting out, no strategy in the game, but changing the strategy can be seen just as leaving and then re-entering with another strategy. And then in total, it's going to be that indeed the difference in the utilities is going to be exactly equal to the difference in the social value. Only here, unlike what we saw before, the potential function checks the difference with exactly the same cost. So it's not like that Vs minus Si Vs prime is equal to Ui S prime minus Ui S, but it's V S prime minus Vs is equal to Ui S prime minus Ui S. The same sign. Let me go to show you what I mean. In the previous cases, we have this opposite signs. Okay. What we have here, we actually define the potential function as that fs minus fs prime is equal to the uis prime minus us. So the order is changing, prime and the original. And then the potential function minima corresponds. Yeah, they're going to do the maximum, especially more natural. Okay, so let's go back. Okay. So we are proving this potential function. And then we conclude that the Nash equilibria are not empty. Actually, any maximizer of the social cost is always a Nash equilibrium. At least those are Nash equilibria, not only those, but at least those. And therefore, the price of stability is of course 1. There are optimal equilibria. Moreover, we can run the best response dynamics in the following, in the sense which we looked at lately. That actually should be the default, not the one I introduced in the first lecture. So what I mean here by best response dynamics is that any player is chosen and that player changes you later at the strategy so that her utility increases. Don't care about what happens to the other utilities. And we know that this is exactly tracked by the change in the potential. So the best response dynamics converge to an equilibrium, but not necessarily to an optimum. Now, how do we prove that? Well, since the set of probabilities is finite, so there is a maximum for welfare, and by definition of the potential function, it means that it's an equilibrium. So every maximum is an equilibrium, and therefore probability is 1. We're proving the first part of the corollary. Now the second part is actually simple too. Since this potential, this response dynamics stop if and only they get to a Nash equilibrium. Now, since this is finite and every move increases and strictly increases the value, it cannot increase indefinitely. It cannot circle because it strictly increases. And since it's finite, it has to stop and therefore it has to go beyond the Nash equilibrium. Now, next we aim to bound the price of amount, having proven existence with, and that there is an optimum equilibrium, we want to bound the price of amount. Now, this actually can be done for a wide class of games, when I define these games as a subclass of the potential games, from which we already get something. But they also a subclass of another kind of games, another class of games, now define, and then we'll use that. So that new class of games is called the utility games. So and the definition is followed. So in a utility game, each player has a set of strategies It's a basic allocation. And let's look at all the locations. Now assume the social function, the social welfare function is defined over all the subsets of the location, not only on single elements, like, well, not what we find on more like k tuples of the locations for each one of the players. But assume that social function is defined for any subset. Now the social optimum will only, what we are interested in, will only consider sets which exactly take one element from each AI, of course, from each player's location. Now, our theory will need here to assume that this function is defined over any subset, and therefore, we denote given any S, in S, any S smaller, S is already a profile here. So this can be it's a profile. That means that each one, which SI is in the corresponding AI, or S is actually the Cartesian product of AI. And denote the social welfare at S as DS, as before, and denote the social welfare of play I as alpha. Simply, we didn't denote it. We talked about it, but we didn't make a notation for that. So denote it by alpha I. Now, the infinity game has to satisfy as three requirements. First, submodularity, that's a classical requirement on set functions. And what it means that if you have two subsets of the subset A and an element there, then adding an element to the smaller subset is always at least as efficient as adding to the larger subset. So it often is the case that if you have something smaller, it doesn't enjoy so much when you add something. So the marginal utility is decreased. It can be the opposite, because it can be that there is some synergy, and the more you have, the more you gain actually from any influx. But in this case, and that's often the case, it can be that simply the marginal utility is decreasing. And another requirement is that for any location, the sum of what all the players get is at most social welfare, and for any location, any player, social welfare of that player. Again, one second, I think I may be confused. Yes. It has to be S in A. It has to be A. No, it's a typo. So for any location S in A, I'm going to change to the correct. And so for any location S in A, adding the location for some player, you just add some location, the marginal what the player gets is at least what the social welfare gains from that. Now the utility gain is called else in addition to having those three qualities. If you have another quality, then this utility game is called basic, and that's if we have an equality in the last requirement. So if what a player gets is exactly, so again, what the player so when you look at what happens for the social welfare in general from that player's location being added, it's exactly the social welfare that player gets after this addition. And the utility game is monotone if simply the value is not decreasing with the set. Now, an important remark is that also we look here only at the providers. As flat as before, so only this extensive game emulation did we look at the providers and the customer's splash. Otherwise, we look at only the private splash and the behavior of the customer is predefined. This is go to the least costly, provider. And we note that in the game we define, in the facility location game, the social welfare is indeed only a function of location. For any customer, looks at how much the customer enjoys being served, minus the cost depending on the location. Now, finally, facility location is a monotone basic utility game. Whole game. One second. Yeah. Yes, that's correct. I'm checking whether you reply or not. So the facility location game is a subcase of the concrete utility game is according to those properties, which I repeat here, those three properties. Plus, it also is basic and monotone, which we now prove. So let's recall the requirements. The first requirement is submodularity, meaning that for any adding to a larger set yields less, then that the total thing that the players get is at most the value of society, then that each player gets is at least what it gives to the society, and being basic means that exactly what it gives to society, and finally, monotonicity means that the value, this function is monotonic. So let's prove it's not hard. The submodularity, it's simply, you just need to maybe get used to this, the definitions and the theorem, but it's not hard. So I'm trying to repeat all the definitions in any new slide so that you can remember what happens. Of course, you can just look in the previous slide, but I'm trying to make it simpler. First property to hold. Because the total social welfare of the players is equal for everyone of the players. Look at who the player serves, and what the player gets is the price that the player is paid minus the cost it costs for the player to provide the service. Now, the price is always at most the value that is at most the sum, and we just replace the price by the value j, how much the service is valued by the customer, and that's exactly the vital value. So from the second property, now property three calls us equality, as shown in proving that actually this is a potential function, the social cost is a potential function. Yeah. That whenever I play whatever player add change, it is exactly change the society, matters to society to the extent it matters to the player. Now let's prove property one. This submodularity. Now by the way, that's a classical property which can be required from a function. Submodularity, and here we have submodularity. Sometimes it requires supermodularity. That's when the inequality direction is reversed. Yeah, and here the proof is simple. So we just need to say that adding a facility to a larger set can only be less important than adding it to a smaller set. So adding a facility can only decrease the service cost. That's how we can change, because we cannot decrease the value of the service to the player. We cannot change. We cannot decrease the service cost, because now there is another option. Now, since the decrease is only smaller when the clients had more choice before the addition, this change is never large, is never larger, it can be only smaller when there was a larger set before the addition. So we have proven 1, 2, 3. And actually we proved 3 with equality, so we also have proven that this is a basic utility game. And we now only have to prove monotonicity. And that's simple because in the facility can never increase the service cost. Well, it does not change how much the cost is important, how much it's valued by the customer. It only changes can decrease the service cost, and thereby the total societal cost can only increase. Okay, so we have proven that our game is a basic monotonic utility game. Now let's look what we can tell about the utility games, which maybe can also be interesting for us. And in general, maybe for other games, sometimes this which can be called utility games. Now, first, for any basic utility game, including our game, of course, we have, so basically, let's just, before we dive into that, let's explain the idea. Take a linear algebra. We often look at some system, and then you say, okay, that's actually, 1 second. Yeah. That's actually a vector space. So you basically abstract out from the non-important details, and you just single out the important details, which you know a lot about. So of course, you could just prove everything from scratch for your concrete case, but that would be much harder because you would have had many, many things which would have simply practically destroyed. So here, we do the same. There's a class of games for which we can prove a lot of interesting things. And then, we just prove that our game is a concrete example of such, or our class in it, is a subclass of this class of games, of utility games, and then we can immediately tell that our game also satisfies certain properties of utility games. So first, for any basic utility game, this third property, this equality, was this one. That the change in the societal value is exactly the change that the player who changes in course. That means the potential gain with the societal value being a potential function. Therefore, known assuming that this set of facilities is finite, we know that there is a maximum value for this VS, for the societal social cost. And since it's the potential, this maximum has to be an equilibrium. And therefore, we have an equilibrium, which is also social optimum. Price of stability is 1. So we have proven that for finite utility, basic utility games, basic utility games are potential games, finite, basic, and if they are finite, then we know that there exists an equilibrium, and the price of stability is 1. Now, a general utility game does not have to have an equilibrium. They're not all these potential games, they may have no Nash equilibrium. However, if you know that the utility game is monotonic, they call it monotone? Yeah, they call it monotone in the book. Probably should be said now. So if the utility game is monotone, and if you know for some reason it does have an equilibrium, such as our game, because our game is also basic. But it's not important. It doesn't have to be basic. If it's monotone and has an equilibrium, then the price stability is at most 2. That's an important, a very cool bound. So for any monotone utility game which happens to have an equilibrium, its value is at least half of the maximum possible. And that's what we prove now, which of course immediate repercussion for our game. So let's prove the statement. One second. Yes. So for any monotone utility game, we need to prove that the value of Nash equilibrium is at least half of the maximum possible value. So let S be Nash equilibrium, and some set O is the maximum possible value. Now from monotonicity, now we're going basically to juggle all those properties and get what we want. Yeah, let's see. From monotonicity, we are going to say that the value of O is at most the value of O with S. Now, you know the strategy of players 1 till I, you know, by OI. So O0 is empty by definition. O1 is what player 1 does, and so on. We assume that this O exactly looks at one thing for each player. And OK here, since there are in general can players, is going to be O. Now from again the monotonicity, we have this the O minus VS is at most VS is O. Simply this implies this. Now we are going to write the second expression, VS unit is O minus VS, as the sum of this telescopic and this telescopic sum. And now for each element of the sum, we're going to look how can we bound that sum moduli implies for each one of both elements that element is at most that, because adding yes, I thought you should have written the index above. So I should be above, clearly. It's not like here it's below, here it's above. That's not what I meant. Okay, I fixed that now. So adding OI, little OI, to S minus large S minus little S I is going to have at least as much an influence over the walls of the wall for social welfare as adding this OI, little OI, to capital S with OI minus 1 by a submoduli. That's why we have this bound on this expression on the right hand side of this sum. Now, property 3 implies that this difference is not exactly if it's basic. Not we don't assume it's basic. At most, the change in the impurity of the player alpha I. And finally, the fact that we assume that it's a Nash equilibrium after all, the change can only make it worse. Combining, we gather that. So basically, this, we just bounded it from above by a by this, and this one we bounded it from above by alpha. So that's plus small I minus small I. Which is probably from above by alpha ns. After all, we just gather that v no minus ns. This is small that one. That's good. The same expression we already have seen. And we can bound it by the sum of those alpha i's. Because each one of the elements in the original sum is bounded by alpha. And then the sum of the alpha i's is the most fierce by property 2 of the infinity game. And therefore, the O is at most 2 Vs, so Vs is at least half of the O, and therefore price finite is at least, at most. Okay, so in particular for our game, of course, that applies. Right? Now, not only do we have this luck that we've seen that the price stability is exactly 1, the price of finite is at most 2, we also can say something really cool. Even if you're not necessarily in an equilibrium, you can bound the expected. Yeah, it's only the expected. It's weaker, but still, we can bound the expected solution quality after simply applying a linear now step of best response, even if you're not in an equilibrium. So look at the following cool theory. Given a, that's actually by the way from another paper, which the book mentions, so if you want, just go to that other paper. But okay, let's go. We do that, and that's enough. So given any subset of location in a monotone basic theory, here requires monotone and basic in particular, the facility location game is such a game as we have proven. Pick the random player and execute best response. So we pick a random player and execute best response. One second. I think there is no mistake in this. Yes. Okay, that's fine. We pick a random plan and execute the best response. So for this plan, we just look at what is the best response to what happens. Then, for any epsilon we are given, small as we want, as someone else wants it, we can run a linear, we can actually know this number depending on the epsilon, a linear in the end, number of such moves, picking a player and doing best response, the player is picked at random. And then, after a linear number of such moves, we know that the expected value of the social welfare will be at least half minus epsilon, so up to epsilon, half of the maximum possible value. So let us reiterate what it means, that for any epsilon we are given, we can calculate exactly what is the constant in this O. We can run a linear number of this picking a random player and doing the best responding for that player. And then we know that next order infinity is going to be at least half up to epsilon, half minus epsilon of the maximum. Now how do we prove that? Now, given such an F and S, which we begin, and some maximum optimum profile low, enough to prove that after one step, the expected utility increases by at least 1 over F, 1 over N of the difference between the optimum and twice the value in this S, for any S. Now, why? Because if that's the case, then after that move, the expected utility is at least n minus 1 over n of the original value. And that can, by a simple manipulation, partially done in the book, but you can do it yourself, implies that the convergence between this factor we want, half minus epsilon, takes at most logarithm of epsilon with the base n minus 1 over n, which is a constant times ln of 1 over epsilon times n. Of course, when epsilon gets smaller, then 1 over epsilon gets larger and ln gets larger. But of course, you know, ln is quite a slow function in that sense, so it's actually good. Okay, so then of course we converge in the linear number of steps when we have this ln of 1 over epsilon is a constant. So any epsilon, that's a linear number in N. Okay. So that's what we need to prove, that after any step, the expected increase is at least 1 over n between the optimum and twice the value of the social value index. That's what we need to prove, and that would be enough. So let's prove it. You know, the maximum possible increase in the utility of player 1 by beta I. And since you look at the player, take a player random, uniform at random, then the expected increase is 1 over n of the average, simply over the players. And since we can select one second, in particular, we can select a change, so which is to the what player does in this optimum, thereby obtaining this increase, and therefore the optimum increase has to be at least as that one. And since the utility game is basic, that's what we assume, it's monotone and basic, then the change in the utility is exactly the general utility is exactly the change in the utility of this player. Now, from now on, we just mirror the previous proof. So it's very similar. Now, the difference between the value of society and optimum minus whatever in S, you can just write this as this telescopic sum. And then, from which when it is bound each term in this sum, from property 3, you know that the last term is at most this one, alpha. So the largest new value we can have. Now, for play I, combining this is property 2, we have property 2 means that the change. Second, let me just recall the property 2. With the sum of alphas. So combining this is property 2. We know that the sum of alphas, so V, okay, let me just go step by step. V0, VO minus VS is at most this sum. Now, every element is bounded by this, and therefore this sum is mostly sum. Now, sum of alphas alone is most, that's the property, and we are left with sum of b's. Now, that implies that sum of b's is at least this, you get greater or equal this. Implies the sum of b's is at least the social value in the optimum minus twice the social value in S. And therefore, the expected decrease in the S is 1 over n, just the average of the sum of b's, as we betas I will send bees instead of bat my apple. The expected decrease, which is 1 over n times this sum, average of those, is 1 over n times this, and that's exactly what we need. As I said above, that would imply the necessary convergence rate. Okay, now let's wrap up what we have been doing in this area of how was this called? Efficient normal network formation and potential functions. We used a potential function on several network formation games. Sometimes we also use this new method of security games. But and let us now just prove. Recap what we've been doing. So those games and different methods, especially the potential function method, are very widespread, way beyond those games, which are important by themselves too. So first, we looked at local connection games. A player could just had to just choose which edge she buys, and then she wants to minimize some of the distances plus minus the cost of those edges. She would pay unilaterally, single-handedly for the edges she has bought, and improve existence, minus an equilibria. As a final bit, perhaps stability was sometimes known to be one, so sometimes we knew that is an optimum equilibrium. But sometimes we just show that it's at most 4 or 3. And about the price of anarchy, what could we tell is that if alpha is at most is smaller than 1, then we could prove that it's one of the exercises in the book. We didn't prove that yet, but we can prove, and maybe we'll do that. That the price of anarchy is at most 1, excuse me, is equal to 1, because there you can show that the optimum equilibrium was the only possible one. But otherwise, if alpha is not strictly smaller than 1, there was this nice theorem that price of anarchy is at most a linear thing in the diameter of the graph. And then, using different bound on the diameter of the graph, we obtained 2 bounds on the price of anarchy, upper bound. Now the second model, second class was global connection game. Which basically was when players needed to connect. Does not matter how long was the connection, as long as it was connected. Each player was basically assigned with a source and a sink. It needs to connect one with the other one by buying a path, and if the players happen to buy a path which uses the same edges as another couple of players, then they would share the cost. Now that we proved to be a potential game, which implied existence of a Nash equilibrium, more of a convergence of a best response to a Nash equilibrium. And we also use that potential to prove that the price of stability is at most the harmonic number, roughly ln of the number of players. And we know it's in general a tight upper bound. Now, finding Nash equilibrium, by the way, we saw an example that Nash equilibrium can be as large as the number of players at least. That's also the upper bound that we didn't. Now, finding Nash equilibrium in general in the potential games, we proved it's a PLS complete problem. Now, if the sink is common, then the cost sharing we chose, the so-called Chaplin cost sharing, where just everyone paid equally for shared costs, would be outperformed, vastly outperformed by a so-called non-oblivious cost sharing, so less reasonable but really efficient in the sense that then the price of anarchy was at most 2. Whereas our cost of our cost sharing resulted in the price of energy sometimes being as large as number of players, in the price of stability being h of k sometimes, or the LAN. Yeah, it allowed for non-oblivious cost sharing. You could have this price of anarchy bounded by 2. But if we wanted if we wanted oblivious cost sharing, then this Shapley was indeed the best of oblivious cost sharing in this efficiency sense. And so if you wanted to always have a Nash equilibrium, it would be the most efficient. And it's of course very natural and can be proven to be really also why it's called Shapley. Can be proven to be corresponding to the famous Shapley value, which we have not studied in this course, but also know that that's a very cool thing. So that's something which definitely is well motivated. So that's there is no reason to use something else unless you allow yourself to use something non-oblivious. If you do, then of course you can indeed get something back. Okay, now facility location games. That's what we need now. So it's a potential game and an optimum, any optimum of the social or the social welfare. It's Nash equilibrium, therefore the price of stability is 1 always. So there is always a Nash equilibrium. The price of stability is 1. Moreover, the best response dynamics would always converge to a Nash equilibrium, but not necessarily to such an optimum one. Now, these games are not only potential, they are also monotone and basic utility games. We've proved that in general, a monotone utility game, including our, but in general, it has all this price of stability at most too. I apologize, it has at most price of anarchy at most. See? Price of what? Price of anarchy. Okay, this effort, yeah. Has to be price of anarchy, yeah. Yes, I fixed that now. Okay, so my apologies for the confusion. Of course we proved that the monotone infinity game has price of anarchy at most. And we also assume, if we assume that the game is also basic, so if it's basic monotone infinity game, then this bound of 2 up to epsilon can be achieved in a linear number of best responses. Okay, so if you have any questions, please do send me a message either in the comments or just mail me. Bye.